we don't want to keep you too long. We waited 10 minutes for the people who are obviously absent from the seats that are on the stage. We think that they should be here. Hear the concerns of the people who work for the city. The reason that I'm concerned about this is because you people are all affiliated with the Central Council, with the King County Labor Council, and this has been one of the few times we haven't been able to talk directly to our councilman or to the mayor about negotiations or any of the problems that the workers have or people have with the city. And so we're dismayed at their lack of attention and response to us. So based on that, we're calling this. And Mike Waske wants to talk to you first, and then we'll start with everybody in the audience airing their complaints and taking down some things, and we will see that it's delivered to them and it gets the proper notification with everyone what your concerns are, and try to have them explain to us why they're absent. And of course, I always like to remind everybody, this is an election year.
Yes, my name is Mike Waske with Local 17. Would like to point out John Rabine, president of the Joint Crafts Council that represents 14 different trade unions in the city of Seattle, is also present here. John, would you come up? And Chris Spieth from Service Employees is also present here. We were in negotiations from 9 o'clock yesterday morning until 6:30 this morning to try to put a package together to come and present to you tonight. I'm sorry to say we were not successful. We drank a hell of a lot of coffee and spent a lot of time talking, but we don't have a package. But the main purpose of this meeting tonight is to bring out a point that we're seeing throughout organized labor, not unique just to the city of Seattle, but it's finally hit home, and that's the union busting consultants and outsiders. Over a year ago, the firefighters, the operating engineers, and I went up to Sam Smith, the president of the Seattle City Council, with the executive secretary of the King County Labor Council, James K. Bender, and said to Mr. Smith, we were very concerned that the city has hired a labor relations consultant, an outsider, to come in and advise them as to what they should do in the contract negotiations. We said we had a problem with that, not with the individual. We pointed out you can hire the snake or the devil himself. As long as you allow us, the union representatives and the employees, to come and explain to you what our demands are, why we're asking for things. So you hear our side of the story. Sam said, no, that's not proper. We can't have that, because labor relations doesn't allow that. Our concern was, then why do you have the other side come in? Why do you listen to the department heads? Why does the Labor Policy Committee listen to department heads, outside consultants, but turn their backs on you? That's why we had the letters sent. We felt we would have some effect upon them, not to negotiate a contract in a public arena, but to point out some of the areas that we're having difficulties at the bargaining table, where they want to take away some of your benefits for injured workers because the costs are very high. We think it's important they hear from you that have been injured on the job as to why we shouldn't have a safer place to work rather than a cheaper place to work or cheaper benefits. I don't want to spend a lot of time on our points, but one that has bothered all of us, and we're seeing it also in private industry, is health insurance. We know the costs have gone up, but the city of Seattle in the last 3 years has had a very unique situation, very unique. There hasn't been any rate increases in the King County Medical. As a matter of fact, the city of Seattle has gotten back in rebates over $1.5 million a year. Over $1.5 million a year in rebates, and they want to cut your health insurance. We think it's time that you tell your point. We're not trying to bleed them. We're not out asking for outlandish salary increases. But it's that you be heard. They question the labor goons like me. the union bosses, Jim, John, I, even Christine. But they question, you don't speak for your membership. Well, I think tonight demonstrates that they don't want to hear from the employees. So we have got a videotape. We want to tape some statements. Our intentions are to make the tape available to the council. Also, we plan to make the tape available in 2 weeks when they come knocking on Mr. Bender's door and say, Cope endorsements are coming up. I would like Labor to consider my endorsement. We'll have a tape that will show who's not here. So that's one of the, also the purposes of the tape. John, would you like to pass on a few words? We formed a coalition. While we maintained our separate contracts, we have formed a coalition with the service employees, with the joint crafts councils, with the laborers unions, to join together to get a master contract or get language that's agreed upon on salary increases, health insurance, etc. We've tried to expedite the process, but to not much avail. John?
Thanks, Mike. Brothers and sisters, this evening isn't the evening for speeches from labor representatives, labor leaders. It's your evening. This is a period, an era in our economy, in our government, when we are seeing very, very difficult times as far as contract negotiations are concerned. We have been involved in negotiations here in attempting to represent through coalition bargaining, joint collective bargaining, representing three major labor groups covering more than 3,000 city employees since July of 1986. We've seen our contract expire back in September of 86, and we have been involved in extensive contract negotiations since July. Now, the contract negotiations this time around have been unlike any of the contract negotiations we've ever been faced with the city in any previous contract negotiations. This time around, the contract proposals that were submitted by the parties were extensive, not so much by labor, but by the city. The contract proposal submitted by the city was in excess of a half an inch thick. That's what has involved ourselves in all the time in attempting to reach an agreement. Not dealing with union proposals that are on the table, but dealing with takeaways that the employer has proposed that we lose and give away in the bargaining process. We, like you, are becoming frustrated with the process because the process is not working. The people who label themselves as friends of labor when it comes to the polls and the time to be elected into their office are turning their backs on the needs of the working people in the city of Seattle. And that's why we're here tonight to voice our opinions, for you to voice your opinions, to make your messages known so that it will effectuate or help or assist us in the bargaining process so that we can accomplish what's necessary in order to get a fair contract for you for the forthcoming years.
So that's why we wanted to hear and we want to offer this as a format for you people to air your concerns. And these are the ones that want to speak. Doug McLean is one that's listed here. Would you like to get up and air some of your complaints?
What we've seen over the last year or so is an increase in inflation. Last year, 1986, we saw a 4% inflation rate. The first 3 months of this year, we've seen 1.5%. What we're looking at is approximately 6% for the full year if it's carried out. The city has only offered us 1.3%, and I really feel that we should at least get back to even to where we were. And the 0.3 that they want to give us retroactive, I think, is absolutely ridiculous in view of the 4% that we saw in inflation. What I'd like to see is a little bit more retroactive, at least, and a better cost of living in the future contract. I think that we deserve this, and I think that we really do have a right to be heard before the city council. Thank you.
Joanne McGovern. I came here to talk about medical insurance. Is that better? I thought that it's pretty apropos that no one is here because it seems like they're not hearing us anyway. There's a lot of dependents that need the medical insurance. Things are not covered under our present medical insurance. It's very expensive. And I thought it should be under a more personalized approach to them to know that we're individuals. We're individuals, and that we're not just one big group, unrecognizable. And I think medical benefits should be kept in the contract and improved if possible. Thank you.
Lou Wright.
I just wanted to make a comment about how it's affecting me personally in terms of being able to survive. I'm one of those members and union members, along with a number of others in Local 17, who probably are a little lower on the economic scale. And I did a little research, and I found myself and several hundred more of us are nearly at the level where we're going to qualify for aid programs in terms of poverty programs. If you have a couple kids and you're making in the realm of $15,000, $17,000 a year, you're almost eligible for poverty programs.
All right.
Right. All right. So, I guess as an active member of Local 17, I'm frustrated. I'm frustrated with these people who many of them we worked for in their elections. And every year they come forward to Jim and to the executive board or the committee that interviews them and wants our blessing. I'd like to see them grilled real hard. In fact, I think I'm going to show up when it starts there. I'd love to be there and hear some of their pleas for support. And I'd like to see us try to get some other candidates on the ballot this fall to challenge some of these people. Thank you very much.
I've been a computer programmer for the city for a year and a half. I'm proud of my job. I enjoy what I do. I feel like if I didn't do my job right, 14,000 city employees wouldn't receive their paychecks on time. A member of the payroll personnel system. And I'm proud of my work, but I want to tell you that if my benefits are cut, if I'm forced to pay out more for my health care benefits, I might as well be working in the private sector because I'm already making less than a private sector employee as a computer programmer. I could be making $6,000 to $7,000 more per year, but I stay with the city because I'm proud of being a public servant. I appreciate the benefits that I contracted for when I signed on as an employee, and I don't want them taken away. Secondly, I'm not a radical feminist liberationist, but I want to tell you, Local 17 has got the highest percentage of women than any other local in this city. And I want to tell you that taking yeah. may be promising us some kind of measure of comparable worth, maybe saying, okay, maybe we'll give this to you, but then at the same time saying, well, then we're only going to give you maybe 1% of a COLA, still puts us well beneath the cost of living increases that are given to the male-dominated trades. I'm not against male-dominated trades. Okay, let me say that. They're fine where they are, but I say that if you're going to be fair, if you're going to give us comparable worth, but then slap us in the face with a tiny little COLA, you haven't done us anything. You've done nothing. Thank you for your attention, and I'm sorry the council people aren't here because I would have liked to have told them to their face.
I work at City Light in the credit office. I'm a member of the Local 17 negotiating committee, and I'm a shop steward, and I have a couple issues that are really close to me. Okay. One of the issues that I'm concerned about that prompted me to want to be involved in the negotiating process of this contract is the VDT safety and health language. Myself and two other employees in my immediate group and another person within the same division have all filed occupational disease claims for carpal tunnel syndrome. After a year of working with arm braces, my claim did go through, and I had surgery in January and February of this year for each of my hands. My coworker here, who has a little sign here, and you notice that she's wearing arm braces because she's still in the claims process, and there are others as well. One of the reasons this condition happens is because our offices are not ergonomically, you know, designed for the workstation. Wrong desks, wrong chairs cause a lot of problems. And it's important for the city council members to understand that we do need to address the problem and have a way of solving it together. My other issue is time loss under the industrial insurance claim system. We have an 80% of pay time loss for our contract now. The city's industrial insurance office says they feel that we should get what the state law says, which is about 62% of your pay. What they don't say is that Washington State only has three states that pay less than us. So we're down there with the lowest of the low. If they want to drop our time loss pay for an injury that happens on the job, they're asking us to go way back. I don't want to see that happen. And I would like to, you know, say to the city council members, give us a little respect. Thank you.
My name is Diana Douglas, and I don't have the money that Princess Di does. I only have the name. I have been a City Light employee for 12 years. My husband has worked for the city for about 14 years. He works for the water department. And I don't really have a personal issue when I come tonight. I'm not a single mother. I am not in jeopardy of my medical insurance because I'm not a single mother. What I am is a city employee who works damn hard every day. I work hard because I have pride in my work. I go to work every day like I'm sure the majority of you do because you have pride in your job. You only want to be treated like an individual and be treated fairly by those folks who don't even have the gumption or the gall to show up and listen to you tonight. These people are elected by people like you. We are voters in this city. When I moved recently, I made sure that I moved within the city limits, so I still had a voice in the people that I work for. And the people that I work for tonight don't even have the courtesy to show up and listen to my concerns or your concerns or anybody else's concerns. I'm sure that 99.9% or 100% of you have pride in your job. You only want a fair contract. You're not asking for the world. You're not asking for above the cost of living. You're only asking to be treated fairly as an employee who works hard and wants to be paid in accordance with the work you do every day.
Hi, my name's Jenny Eichwald. I'm an administrative support assistant in the Department of Licenses and Consumer Affairs. I can't understand how the city can spend $12,000 on labor consultants and not spend any money on studying VDT hazards and ergonomics. I mean, the concern that we have is safety in the workplace and incentives for good health. Instead, there are punitive measures being undertaken and proposed to make our industrial accident stuff worse. What I'm most concerned about, though, is the health insurance, especially when I look at the city council having been able to put millions of dollars into the general fund and then telling me they want to take $50 a month out of my paycheck. Give me a break. The bottom line of this is it's very demoralizing to continue to try and be a good city employee when this is the treatment we get from city council, empty seats. Remember this when the next election comes around, all I can say, and if you guys are getting complaints about how city employees are treating the public, what goes around comes around.
I work for City Light, and I came here prepared to read about four pages of crap here and to bombard the city council members and the mayor, but since they're not here, I won't bore you all. I don't need to convince all of you. But what I am going to do is take this and type it up, and I'm going to send it to all of them. But what I closed this with was the fact that I'm a real active Democrat, and I'm a member of the executive board of the 36th District Democrats. And I intend to follow all of these council members around to all of the district meetings of the Democratic organizations this summer. And I am going to let all of the Democrats in town know what the city council has proposed for us. And I don't think that most of the Democrats in town are going to be too happy about it. Most of them like labor. Most of them have been our friends and our supporters over the years. I would also urge all of you, whether you be Democrats or the few Republicans that there may be in here, that you go to your district organizations, call the King County Democrats or Republicans, find out where your legislative district meets, join your legislative district, and when these people come around looking for endorsements this summer, stick it to them. You know, they don't need our help. I worked for a lot of these people. I've carried literature for a lot of them because I thought they were decent, honorable, progressive people. And all of this has made me rethink a lot of that. And I'm frankly a little bit ashamed that I've spent the time helping them that I have. And I don't intend to do it again.
I'm Margie Jones, and I just want to say to the City Council that I find it interesting that your staff assistants pushed through a reclassification that gave them a nice increase, and you won't negotiate with us fairly to give us a fair cost of living increase. I can't believe you would treat some employees one way and the rest of us without any dignity at all. Thank you.
My name is Jim Egan. I work for the people who charge you the high garbage rates, but anyway, if you look in this morning's paper, in last night's paper, you'll see where these fine people up here have voted, four of them, to give a developer who's building a tower in Westlake $10 million not to build it. Now, I think that rightfully belongs to us. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Daryl Merkel, and I work along with Jim through Solid Waste. And I'm sorry for all you guys' high garbage bills, but it's not my fault. It's those people's fault up there. Now, I make less money than a county driver does, and I don't give a damn because I'm proud to work for the city of Seattle. But they're taking too many things away, and now they want to take away my job and farm it out to a private contractor. All of Solid Waste Utility. Now, is this going to be the way with everybody's job around here? Is this the attitude the city's going to take? I mean, how much are they going to take from us? And I was going to take all those guys out for dinner, but I guess I don't have to now. Thank you.
Next is Kathy Cook. And then after her is Vicki Wegg.
Hey, I've been with the City Light for almost 9 years now, and I enjoy my work. I'm proud of my work, and I enjoy where I work. I'm also a working mother and the sole support of four growing daughters. My concern is the increase in the medical benefits that the city wants to shaft us with. I, for one, cannot afford any more increases, especially if they don't even want to give us a pay raise to help cover it. And I'm tired of the city council and the city Mickey Mousing around and trying to give us the sham and not negotiating a decent, fair contract with us when we work our butts off to help them out. And I even voted for some of those jerks up there, and I'll be damned if I'm going to do it again.
Next
My name is Vicki Wegg. I work at City Light. I've been there for 10 years. I'm a shop steward for Local 17. I'm proud of both positions, by the way. I want to talk about the comparable worth issue, which may or may not be a good idea. The way the city has developed the plan, it's become a farce. I'm an accounting tech too at City Light, and I have not been given a justifiable reason for exempting my classification along with admin spec 2s and 3s, and I want to know why we were left out. Those of us assigned in these job classes are as dedicated and hardworking as the Tech 1s and the Tech 3s. We now feel like the typical middle child, and we want to be included in the family of clerical workers who have been named more worthy. Thank you.
I'm Yolanda Alanise, and I work at the Water Department. I'm a customer service rep. I'm glad that Swan raised the VDT issue because we have 10 operators and we've had like 4 claims already. And Ethel Marie is a very good example because her arm was hurting all day today. Her hands are swollen. She's having a hell of a time, and I hate to see that. She that won't come up here, so I'm just going to say, I hate to see her go through that because no worker should go through that. And I hope the union really moves on that because it's really affecting the type of job we do. What I wanted to say was that I called Sam Smith and I said, hey, Sam, all of us are talking here in the water department. Are you going to be at the meeting Wednesday night? Oh, no, no, I can't get involved. I can't get involved. But believe me, I'm a pro-labor person. Yeah. Right. He said that. He says, but believe me, I'm pro-labor. I said, well, Sam, if you're pro-labor, why aren't you going to come to the meeting? Oh, no, I can't get involved. This is the thing I want to say to Sam Smith, is that he is involved. He's involved on the wrong side. Yeah. He can't. It's a contradiction. If he's pro-labor, they wouldn't hire the consultant they would have. He would be here tonight. He would be here to address these issues. And I just want to say that I think the union should stand strong on all the issues. Maybe medical benefits aren't going to affect each and every one of us, but we've got to stick together on that issue, just like I&I may not affect every one of us. We've got to stick together on that. The same thing goes with discrimination. Even if you haven't felt it in your life, it does exist, and we have to take a stand against it. So I like to say that the union also has to stand real strong against discrimination and for the appeal process, that I know you are doing that, and I really want to enforce that because they busted HRD, they got rotten directors in there. I worked for one of them for a reason, to bust HRD, to bust the Human Rights Department, so they wouldn't have a city department to be able to deal with it. So it's up to us as union people to deal with discrimination.
Hi, I'm Kathy Clark Williams. First of all, I'm a VDT operator, word processor operator for City Light. I've been working for the city in August. It'll be 17 years. Now, what most people aren't aware of when they look at me is that I'm an employee with dual handicaps. 4 mastoid surgeries leaves me partially deaf. Spinal fusion leaves me with physical problems. Now, as an employee, one of the most important things to me is that medical benefit. Because of the fact that if I have an ear infection, I can't wait until I have the money to go see a doctor. And if I've paid the rent and blown my paycheck, hey, I still can't wait. I have to get in and see a doctor. Take care of these problems before it gets aggravated. Now, I realize that to the city, it doesn't matter, you know, I mean, I'm just a little person. But I find it interesting that the city keeps documents, keeping track of us handicapped employees. They're an equal opportunity employer, and they hire the handicapped. Well, now, as a handicapped employee, I need some help too, and that's one reason why I hope that we don't do anything to aggravate or change our medical insurance. Thank you.
My name's Luma Nickel, and I'm a meter reader with the Water Department. I'm the first woman who stuck around in that job for more than a year. Now we have 2 other women on the crew, and we also have a racially integrated crew. What I want to say, since the city council isn't here, is to the negotiating team, is to stand firm on all of the issues in question, because they're all very important. I don't want a half of a percent of a pay raise. And I want to be able to grieve discrimination issues through the union. And I think that if you look around this room tonight, you'll see that you have a lot of support, a lot of people backing you up, so don't back down. Thank you.
My name is Larry Works, and I work at Seattle City Light. I'm a shop steward, and I've worked at City Light for 13 years. And I'd like to thank all of you for coming tonight, for taking time out from your busy schedules. Besides Local 17 members, there are people from Joint Crafts, Amalgamated Transit, Service Employees, AFSCME 1083 and 1083C, Local 763, Local 77, IBEW, at least. And there are probably others that I've left out. There are non-represented employees here, too. Thank you all for coming. This show of solidarity will benefit all of us. The issue goes beyond specific language in our contract. Our elected representatives are engaged in a wholesale boycott. They're refusing to have contact with city employees. The city council members will listen to a department head or a deputy superintendent, but they can't be bothered to listen to ordinary city employees. I know this from my personal experience, from writing letters to which I get nothing, not even a response. They can't be bothered. Yesterday, someone working downtown cut through some underground lines, and the result was a massive outage, a major problem for Seattle. The solution? Call on city employees, in this case mostly members of IBEW Local 77. Think about it for a minute. There was a crisis involving electric power, and the city called upon our city employees with the utmost confidence. There was no hesitation. There was no thought of referring the problem to a committee or to an outside consultant. Fortunately for the people of Seattle, we know how to do our work without asking a consultant how. There was immediate mobilization of a well-trained, professional, experienced workforce. And I've left out one word in describing those workers: dedicated. Some of those people worked over 24 hours straight, so the people of Seattle could have their full electrical system restored. The example I'm using is Local 77 people, but we in Local 17 do the same thing. Our members are called on in the middle of the night to answer phones and to repair storm damage. We don't refuse to answer our telephones at home, even though it may be 2 a.m. We don't tell our supervisors to refer their request to a committee. We don't ask a consultant whether we should do the work. We respond. What the city council members are doing might be okay with Cabot Dow, but that doesn't make it right. They may have hired a $75 an hour brain with the people's money, but that doesn't make them smart, and it doesn't make us stupid. We are citizens. We are taxpayers. We are ratepayers. We are voters. We have a right to be heard. We will be heard. Thank you.
My name is Wendy McClure. I work in Department of Human Resources at one of the community service centers, the one in the U District. I've been a city employee for 2 years. I'm glad I'm a city employee, but I'm a little disappointed with the turnout we've had up at the front of the room. The community service centers are sort of in a unique position. We're often the place where citizens stop in the little city hall to get some kind of assistance from the city. We are often also the place that paves the way when a city council person or the mayor needs to meet with the community, has a problem with the community, needs to get some communication across. I'm sorry they're not here to hear that we're trying to communicate with them, that we have needs, we have health care benefits that we deserve. We put the sweat of our labor into their needs, and we need some compensation through health care benefits. We also need good working conditions. If the VDT screens are bad, they need to be looked at. That needs to be paid attention to. It's also the case that our community service center staff work extensively to pave the way when the mayor needs to come out and meet with a community. We pave the way when the council needs to come out. It's time the council and the mayor pave the way for us to have good working conditions and a good contract.
Hello, my name is Barbara Price. I work for the City Light. I work in distribution engineering. That's the people that provide you with your electricity. And I recently heard, actually this morning, that my fellow workers in the other end of the building have been told that they need to double their productivity because our managers overestimated how much work they could do. And they're telling us that they want to give us a 1% raise. The rate of inflation is, as stated in our bargaining update, 6.7%. If you subtract 1% from what you would get, plus pay $50 a month in health insurance, your total loss in real dollars, if you make $20,000 a year, is $1,600. So you would actually, in real buying dollars, be making, I didn't subtract that part, but a lot, well, that $1,600 less, you'd only be making, you know, $1,800 and $400. Anyway, women head of households make up 50% of the population that is below the federally designated poverty line. And you're telling these women that are single mothers that they have to pay $50 a month for their medical insurance, and you're only going to give them a 1% raise? Give us a break here. And I'm an engineer, okay? And I subscribe to a magazine that's quite good, and they've just recently done a survey that shows that the professional engineers and technicians at City Light are getting paid $2,000 to $6,000 less than the national average for 1986. So, 1% is not enough. I have 4 children that I support. $50 a month to medical insurance isn't going to get it. I want my health insurance. I want a raise, a reasonable increase.
80%.
I want the people that have to work with VDTs to be working in a safe environment. I'm going to have to be working on those one of these days because we're going to computer. Everyone's going to have to be working on those. And I want the people that are injured on the job as a result of unsafe working conditions, VDTs, to be allowed to be compensated for those injuries that are caused by unsafe working conditions, caused by the management, not by the labor. And that's all I have to say.
Doreen McGrath. We don't have permission for this, sir. This is on the list.
Okay. My name is Alan Yamaguchi, and I work with City Light, and I've been there for about 10 years. And I'm an officer of Local 17, and I'm a member of the contract or the negotiating committee. And, you know, I'll tell you, I too have a list here that Brother Cato had also, you know, that he was going to spiel out to the people who are not here. And it really ticks me off when the city proposes, the original proposal in wage was 0.5%, and in the past we've been taking 80% of the CPI, which means that the dollar has been going back and back and farther for each one of you people here. And it ticks me off when they say that they make this proposal and give this to us and say, we think this is fair. You know? And I've been sitting on that table for, God, it's been months now that we've been involved in this. I tell you, the next time I see him, or the city's negotiating team, I really do want to see a fair proposal. It just bothers the hell out of me.
My name is Doreen McGrath, and I work at Seattle City Light. I am not a represented employee. I'm not represented by any union. But I am concerned about all the issues that are particularly in the Local 17 bargaining update sheet, because if they change the insurance, health insurance with Local 17, you're damn well going to change it for unrepresented employees, too. If they, the problems with the VDTs, I work with computers all day also, and so the problems with VDTs affect me also. Sitting in lousy chairs definitely affects me all, you know, all day. So these are some of the obvious things that I think why I support Local 17 in the negotiations and why I wanted to tell the city council that they had better get on the stick about this, because this has been very ridiculous from what I've been able to see. The other thing that isn't so obvious is that by having the unions in the building, as a mess as much as City Light is, it still changes the climate and it helps even us non-represented employees. I work with the Committee for Equal Rights at City Light, Circle, and I have seen Local 17 and other employees file grievances on discrimination, and I have seen behavior change because they have won and they are winning things. And it has made my life and everybody else's life a hell of a lot better, excuse me, but it has made people's lives a lot better. And that clause and all the things in the contract are very important for everybody who works for this city.
I'm Fran Wallace, and I work for City Light. I've been, okay, I'll get in a little further. This is the first time anybody complained that my voice is too soft. I work for City Light. I've worked for the city 28 years now, split service. And in the 50s, when I first came, I think I started as a steno for $260 a month, maybe less. It was not a desired job. 1 year, we got our medical instead of a raise. It was probably cheaper. We got $5 a month, you know, raise on a bad year and 20 in a good one, and we got medical 1 year instead of a raise. We've gotten every one of our fringe benefits, our medical, our dental. Now they've done, state industrial is no longer state industrial. They're self-insured. They're cutting and slicing on that too because it's cheaper. They're saving money on us. And they're trying to save a hell of a lot more. And if we let them get away with it on this, very much of this on this contract, the next contract, it'll be more. Because we're losing things that we've had for 30, 35 years. And we should not have to lose that much that we have had that long. And we have to hang together. Because otherwise, I mean, sure, I'm going to be gone within 10 years. But not all of you are. Not all of you are. And what they do to retired people after they get through with the active ones might be a prize, too. If we don't stand now and think forward, we're cutting our own throats.
My name is Terry Bach, and I work at Seattle City Light. I'm a member of the International Brotherhood of Electrical Workers. Some people on my crew had told me that they intended to come tonight to be here at this hearing to talk to the city council and the mayor. A lot of them worked a long time last night in downtown Seattle, and I know that some of them weren't able to come because of that. I myself worked and was late in signing up to speak because of that reason. It's interesting to me to see the number of chairs here tonight of city council members and our mayor who are not here to listen to us. And in thinking about why that might be, it occurred to me that maybe they really don't see us as citizens of the city of Seattle. We're just employees, right? We really don't have a voice, and so maybe we're just second-class citizens. And I'm here to tell you that the reason we worked last night was not just because we were second-class citizens. I appreciated the comments of Larry Works. It's because we're first-class citizens. We see ourselves not only as employees, but also we got a responsibility to this town, and we intend to be treated like citizens by the council and by the mayor. One of the things that's the most important to me of the issues that Local 17, and I want to thank Local 17 and the King County Labor Council for organizing this hearing. I think it's very important not only to Local 17 and the Joint Crafts, but also to us, the rest of us in unions in the city of Seattle. One of the issues that's so important to me is the industrial insurance issue. Those of us who are in the electrical trades at City Light, especially those of us who are women, and many of us who are minorities, face enormous industrial injury rates. Women on the line crews, for instance, have 105% industrial injury rate at City Light. A lot of it is due to discrimination. It's no secret that City Light is one of the worst departments in this town for discrimination, and it has high stakes if you work in a dangerous trade. I went downtown and I found that there's a city ordinance. It's called Ordinance 111756. This ordinance says that every city employee of the city of Seattle has the right to receive 80% industrial injury pay compensation and 100% for the first 5 days. Nobody's excluded. So I'd like to know where the city officials get off proposing that this ordinance be violated in this contract with Local 17. For any full-time permanent employee, all of us have the right to industrial injury pay. Now, if it's lost with Local 17, it's a law of the town. Where are they going to stop? They're going to rewrite the law. And that means a lot to all of us. Somebody got up here and said that city employees and city unions need to be united together on these issues of the current negotiations. I think that's really the crux of the matter, because here, then they won't be able to treat us like we're not citizens. We've got a big statement to make. We're a lot together. When we negotiate just as separate unions here and there, we're going to negotiations. IBEW is going to negotiations this summer for a new contract. Whatever is done with Local 17 will make a big difference to us. So I think we do need some sort of umbrella organization or coalition to make a statement as employees and first-class citizens of this town.
Hello. My name is Jack Aubrey. I work at the Seattle Center. I'm a shop steward carpenter for the city of Seattle. There are several points I want to make for myself and my fellow workers at the Seattle Center. First, I want to state that we at the center are unique because we handle special events and are a 24-hour workforce there, and we understand that. What we don't understand is why we're being singled out as the primary workforce to be divided and union busted. I wonder why we are being told by city negotiators that we will pay $27 a month for parking. Could it be the new parking overhead increase of over $100,000 per year at the center is causing this? And that's a fact. You know, and things like this, we are being discriminated at, and we're the test case there at the Seattle Center. We're asking for a meal allowance at the Seattle Center because a lot of times we have to work 10, 12-hour shifts, okay? The old schedule was a $5 meal tip. Now, you go out anywhere and have a dinner, meat and potatoes and vegetable, and try and buy it for $5. There's no way. So we'd like to have it increase. One unbelievable thing of the city is that it's asking its employees to pay 20% of medical coverage with a $100 deductible. Now, that's ridiculous. The main reason we come to work for the city is because of its benefits. It's surely not the wages that we got us interested in working for the city. I mean, hell, outside, a carpenter gets $17.86 an hour plus benefits. Right now, I get $13.74, and that's it. So, you know, them cutting in our benefits is definitely going to make us vote no in the contract. Last but not least, in my concerns, and it's paramount in my mind, is about the negotiations, is the date of the old contract ending. Now, the date of the old contract, it ended on September 1st, 1986. The negotiator is asking that we forget all about this date, that we start a new date for starting of a new contract of April 1987. Now, that's totally ridiculous. Now, first of all, if a man did that to me, I'd call him a thief and I'd shoot him. I mean, that's ridiculous. A man's stealing from me since September of 1986 all the way till now, and then I don't get compensated for it. That's ridiculous. He's a thief, and the negotiators are a thief for doing that. I think you should evaluate I'm saying this to the council. I think you should evaluate your negotiator's stand on the issues, because we will definitely not accept any city proposal that is ridiculous as one put forth to the mediator. I mean, you know, we want fair and equal compensation for our work. We're not getting it.
I'm Roy Gould from Local 17, shop steward for Seattle Engineering Department. I'm looking at those empty seats up there, and I see seven names I've given money to. I see seven names of people I've hand-billed for in my precincts. And I am looking at five names. Five of those names are up for re-election in November. And I am going to go out. I'm just about ready to go out looking for five people to support who are opponents of theirs, and to give money to, and to hand-bill for who are opponents of theirs. And I'm wondering how many other people in the room there are who are going to help the opponents of these five people who are up for re-election tonight, feeling the way we do.
Tonight to stand up and say, that's not right. We're all together. It's not Telegram to every single one. This is what it said. It was mailed April